Let's go.
Hey everyone, and welcome back or welcome to my channel. Today's topic will be the sequel to my trilogy of why I'm worried about this K-pop group, with Purple Kiss being the next group. Once again, this video concept was inspired by Jihoon's Carrot, so make sure to check them out. As for why Purple Kiss, I kinda tunneled in on the fact that their debut was pretty unique and the whole debut album was almost perfect to me. Yet after that, low-key, I really haven't paid too much attention to them, which is kinda strange. I mean, the reason why I'm putting off Lightsome and Weekly's video is because I want to see how their comeback does before I say anything, and yet here I am being a clown, not realizing that Purple Kiss is in the middle of their newest comeback. So that kind of explains how much I've overlooked them, but maybe potentially others too, based on other factors that I'll be discussing. But yeah, the plan is to take a similar approach to my last video about Cherry Bullet and talk about the factors impacting their career. So before I start, I'd appreciate it if you can like and subscribe to my channel. Without further ado, let's start off with the first factor. Purple Kiss's concept, which I would describe as Halloween quirk, is a double-edged sword. On the one hand, it's what made Purple Kiss stand out on initial debut, as there were very select few groups who followed a similar darker concept, all being relatively less known. As a result, this set them apart from the more commonly used concepts and have also made them relatively more memorable as they've been able to commit to this concept. However, the downside to their concept is the fact that there is kinda a reason why those basic concepts are overdone. It is ultimately casual listener friendly, especially within Korea, and so Purple Kiss's concept attracted attention, but this doesn't mean they retain it just like that. We can also kind of see within their concept counterparts, as there is no clear girl group that dominates undeniably with that concept. I mean, the most thriving group with a similar concept would be Dreamcatcher, and they had to take their time to develop such a solid fan base to get to a certain level of recognition. But then, to add to that, two songs that were thriving and topped the year as songs with longevity during Purple Kiss's debut were Stacey's ASAP and Weekly's After School, which are complete opposites to Purple Kiss's concept. And so despite setting themselves apart from the industry, they also started restricting themselves through their concept, as this would become the expectation of listeners for Purple Kiss. The dark concept would explain the whole Halloween part of the concept, however, the quirk would come in after a year through their sound. Despite the concept sounding restrictive, it didn't stop them from branching out musically, as seen in their versatile title tracks. We would see more of an experimental sound during their second year, which further created divisiveness within casual listeners and initial fans. Experimental music involves a bit of risk, considering there is a lack of representation of the musical sound, meaning there is no definite listeners or market they're targeting. The comebacks of Mim Mim and Nerdy received mixed reception, and thus can kind of explain why we would start to see a slight downwards trend in terms of their album sales success. As of recent, their current comeback of Seven Heaven has seen a departure from their Halloween quirk concept for more of a summer concept. Obviously, we can't say that they've completely ditched their Halloween quirk concept, considering this is just a single album, but this shift does put them in a slight position if they try to make their concept more versatile. There is a bit of importance for Purple Kiss to keep their concept intact, as it has formed a big part of their identity, which could alienate some of their core fan base if they were to completely deviate. However, this doesn't mean that they can't switch up, as they can through their sound or through a smoother transition. Overall, Purple Kiss's concept has helped them stand out in a positive way. However, the distinction of Purple Kiss's concept means nothing without this next factor. Another issue with Purple Kiss is their lack of visibility within the industry. While their pre-debut had some decent and impactful activities that helped generate their pre-debut hype, like Gone and Jihoon being in Produce 48, Chen being in K-pop Stars, and Dozy being in Mix 9, their promotions after debut has progressively just disappeared to the point where it doesn't feel like they exist much beyond music show appearances. This can hinder their growth opportunities and decrease the likelihood of being able to retain interest. Even the bare minimum of engaging with fans through social media can help in sustaining a level of support. Despite their talent, this kind of means nothing within the K-pop industry if viewers can't get exposed to them through their promotions, which RBW seems to be falling short on. There have been some attempts through putting them in survival shows, however, I'm not too sure how impactful they've actually been for Purple Kiss. Starting off with Artist.Game, which was pretty low-key, which I feel like barely anyone would have gotten much out of that show. Then we had Girls Reverse, which also, like I said in the Cherry Bullet video, the whole show's premise was about a virtual reality girl group, and so we really weren't about to get much promotion for the actual groups associated to the voices. Finally, we would have Queendom Puzzle, which has seen a decent amount of success as Yuki participated and made it to the final lineup in third place. Since Queendom Puzzle was aired through Mnet, as well as the group being managed by WAKEONE, this has the potential to change the trajectory of Purple Kiss, depending on the reception and promotion of Ellzup. Survival shows aren't the only ways solo activities can be given. However, this has also been lacking for the group, which is another missed opportunity for certain members to utilize their skills and talent to bring more attention to Purple Kiss. I mean, Swan and Gone have done some OSTs. Swan has already made her solo debut, which personally I feel like kind of did nothing. And then, yeah, other than that, there has been nothing to Dozy, Ire, and Jiyun's name, which also reflects the line distribution, which heavily favors Swan and Gone. Like, I get that they're the main vocalists and should get a bit more lines and all that, but looking through their whole music catalog, the distribution is low-key pushing it to the point where it's looking a little bit more sus. Overall, we see RBW's treatment to certain members a bit more prevalent than others, when the others could unlock some unseen potential by the general public. I mean, Yuki was given Queendom Puzzle only, which she's already garnered more attention than I would say Swan's two survival shows, OSTs, and solo debut. Who's to say Dozy, Ire, or even Chaeyoung could have the potential to bring in more attention to Purple Kiss? This applies to basically all groups that aren't seen as contenders for leading the fourth gen, considering the state of the industry. We have seen an exponential increase in K-pop consumption, and thus a byproduct of this has been more entertainment companies attempting to get their piece of that K-pop pie. Add to that is the fact that the K-pop industry isn't like the Western market in which eras were long lasting. For K-pop groups, they usually pump out two comebacks a year as the bare minimum. And so if it's not a new debut happening, then it's probably a new comeback from an existing group. As a result, the K-pop market has been so oversaturated and has allowed listeners to be able to pivot, become a multi-stan, or even just a casual listener without the companies really receiving monetary gain to allow the groups to cyclically come back from their success. For Purple Kiss, they debuted at an okay time that allowed them to stand out as refreshingly different. However, they had such a short time to quote-unquote establish themselves before we would see a surge of large girl groups coming from both post-IZ*ONE and the Big 3 and HYBE. I mean, to list out the groups that would follow after Purple Kiss, we had IVE, Lightsome, Kepler, Got The Beat, Le Sserafim, NMIXX, and NewJeans. All these other groups had more leverage and foundational support from stronger associations that allowed for more pre-debut and debut hype for them. It just meant that Purple Kiss became lower on the priority list of giving them a chance. Once again, this doesn't even factor in the comebacks of existing groups who would have had more of a history and connection with K-pop listeners. And then as well as that, their concept and musical identity separated them from the competition both in a good and bad way. So overall, the industry was fierce for them despite being rookies. To ultimately succeed and hold their own, strategic promotions and a favorable, unique selling point becomes crucial to setting themselves up. However, their unique selling point has been met with mixed reception over time, and also promotions have not been that strategic or effective, and instead more non-existent, to the point where they have room to fight, but could easily get swallowed up by the oversaturated market. Okay. So Success for a K-pop group can be attributed to their company's use of resources and opportunities to provide them the ability to grow and thrive. Without it, even the most talented groups can struggle to reach their full potential. This kind of explains why being in a bigger company gives a certain level of security, as you'd assume they have the ability to provide these things. Whether they actually use it though, that's a different story. For RBW, this has been lacking for a while now, seen through how Mamamoo has been treated from their contract renewal era to as of now. And considering how popular Mamamoo has been, and to see this mismanagement, it just doesn't look great for Purple Kiss too. In defense of RBW though, they have been known as Mamamoo's company for a long time, which kind of shows the power that Mamamoo has had in raising up RBW. However, just because they've brought up RBW, it doesn't mean that RBW is just able to instantly do big three things too. I think people are slightly overestimating the power and influence of RBW, considering no RBW group has been able to replicate or elevate RBW's name. Mamamoo's success has allowed for more listeners to check out the debut of RBW's rookie groups. However, this also does not equate to instant fame or loyal fans, as we can see through all the RBW groups have slow rises in popularity as opposed to instant success. This doesn't excuse the questionable actions or lack of actions, considering them and HYBE have also been two of the more prominent companies to make news for acquiring companies. I mean, from WM Entertainment, DSP Media, and Urban Works, there are definitely many benefits to acquiring many entertainment companies to diversify their potential for success. But in acquiring these companies, this requires a certain level of funding to purchase the shares associated. I'm not sure how much it all costed and all that, but those funds become opportunity costs to elevating Purple Kiss or even other RBW groups, as now they take on the responsibility of ensuring their subsidiaries are doing all right too, meaning their attention for Purple Kiss gets cut. And finally, this is just miscellaneous factors that are a bit shorter in discussion. Starting off, they debuted in the height of the pandemic, and so they started off limited in their ability to promote themselves in front of an audience. It wasn't until their nerdy era when they got to perform in front of an audience, which has a decent amount of impact. K-pop is all about fan engagement, and thus groups thrive more when they are able to connect with their fans through the experiences of performing. As a result, not performing to audiences weakens the bond that a fan might have for a group. And thus, depending on the competition, one disappointing release can see the pivot of the fans to other groups. This might be confusing since, in terms of sales, not performing in front of an audience saw the biggest success in terms of album sales, and so you would low-key expect them to get further attention once they're able to perform live with audiences. However, I feel like the strength and loyalty for Purple Kiss wasn't as strong, and so the era of experimenting with their music kind of offsetted the positives from being able to perform live. As well as that, another incident that would also slightly impact the group would be the departure of Jiyun, which was due to persisting poor health conditions and anxiety symptoms. Although usually an extremely impactful event, Jiyun's departure actually didn't impact them too much. Obviously, fans were sad to see her leave. However, the reasoning gave more justification for fans to accept her departure and wish her the best. As for casual listeners, she wasn't really utilized as much, and so there wasn't too much of a rearrangement to the point where the song was noticeably different. These two factors have had some form of impact to the group in some sense, but it varies between how impactful they are to fans, and then to me, it low-key feels not too impactful, but I did want to throw it in as discussion points because they did ultimately impact the group in some sense. Final thoughts. Despite these concerns, I do want to note that they're still relatively newish in their career, so they do have time. I know there's an expectation of instant popularity. I mean, even in my Cherry Bullet video, I said there is a cost associated with taking time to develop the group. However, I feel like Purple Kiss is a slightly different situation-ish. RBW as a company has never been the type to have outright success with their groups, as they focused more on talent. Purple Kiss does have the talent and potential, but it seems like their journey will be filled with more hurdles until listeners start to kind of get it. I would equate equate their situation of talent outweighing their recognition as similar to NMIX, like one strong release, and I feel like they could ride the waves. In saying that, RBW hasn't completely neglected Purple Kiss, as they have announced a US tour for them, which I'm low-key surprised about, but these are those types of risks, but also opportunities that RBW should be taking in order to expand their fan base and kind of look for more markets to target. But yeah, that's it for the video. Thanks for watching, and let me know your thoughts on Purple Kiss, their career so far, and what you think their future might look like. I did want to round this off with a final group, considering this was initially supposed to be a trilogy of groups that I'm worried about. I had a look through groups that I knew a decent amount about. One group in mind was WAKEONE, but while reading my comments, I discovered another YouTuber who kind of does real similar videos to this concept, and I feel like they talk about WAKEONE's journey pretty well. However, one group that I haven't seen as much attention has been Classy. I knew them more because of their survival show that I watched, and having a quick look into what they've been up to so far, I feel like they might be niche, but a good interesting video discussion to have. But yeah, if you're interested in any of these groups I've mentioned, then please like and subscribe to keep up to date, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye!